Welcome back. So, for those of you who are just with us, which I'm pretty sure is nobody, we were just playing some Go. And now, for those of you who are with us, we'll be playing some chess on Lichess. Unfortunately, I can't stream this live because my internet is out. So, I'm doing this mobile and recording it on my PC, tethering everything together. And we're going to, I guess, do some offline streaming and then upload it. So hopefully that proves enjoyable. We'll see how the format goes. So as not to consume all my data, I'm playing like Go and chess and things where, well, I guess I could play even more graphically intensive things that wouldn't matter, but things where there's not lots of network traffic is the point. So we're gonna play some correspondence chess. I have not done this in forever. Standard correspondence, days per turn, we'll say a week per move. Or should I bump that down to 3 days? Or faster? I'm not sure if I could get to something every three, but let's say 5 days per move. Take all comers. I'm rated 2085 correspondence. So let's put a seek out there. Hello and good luck. All right, so correspondence. Let's. I want to get back in the swing of playing e4. Oh, I did turn on move confirmation for correspondence. All right, let's create another correspondence game. Here we go. Hello and good luck. Good luck. Okay. Now I thought there was an in-game settings menu I could use to select, like, do I want to automatically go switch between my games? There's the main menu. That's not what we're looking for. There's my username, which shows games in progress and such. Game behavior. Dot, dot, dot. Let's see. Promote to queen, take backs, pre-moves, click and drag, game display. Strange. I don't see a thing to auto-switch between games. All right. So hopefully on my profile page it should show my games, right? Two playing. It's not my move in either one of these. So I guess we wait. How many correspondence games should I pick up at once? And then the downside of these, well, let me pick some faster ones too. We'll pick some slow ones, play some fast ones. 2 days per turn, or 1 day per turn? Do we have 1 day? We do. I still think one is pretty fast. So let's pick three. Random color, 3 day correspondence. So let's turn on some sound. So you have some ambience. Hello and good luck. So we're gonna get back in the hang of playing e4. Let's create another. Oh, never mind, he's moved. Okay, we're gonna create another correspondence game. I hope those challenges are persistent. As in, like, if I navigate away from the page, it's still there. So I used to play knight f3 all the time. This is how I used to play these openings, and how I think I still do. Well, I could see my current games down here. Let's pick auto switch. Hello and good luck. I say good luck. Apparently the hello button and good luck button did not take. All right, so e4. Knight c6. All right. So I wonder. Let's play the way I used to play, bishop c4. And this does prompt for move confirmation. So that's cool too. At some point, I do want to experiment more with the play by typing feature. I think that'd be more fun for blitz than for other formats. So we're playing some 3-day correspondence. Could start up some more games. I'm just afraid that at some point I'll pick up too many games and end up losing them all on time, but I think I can keep up. This is kind of a huge commitment, by the way. And for those unfamiliar. All right, so it's my move against Amaztor. Indeed. Here. There's no luck in chess. Except in when you play in a tournament and you get paired with an opponent. What opponent you get is somewhat random. So there is that element of luck. Now, do I castle or do I play d4 here? I like this position. I like d4. I kind of like c3. I've not seen the Hungarian defense in a long, long time. Do I castle? Do I play knight c3? Do I play d4? I keep saying these things over and over as if repeating things is going to help me. And at to some small extent, it does calm the mind. But I need some energy too. I can't just play on autopilot. So I really like the idea of d4. Unless he can somehow get in d5 freely. But I don't think he can. d4 frees my bishop. What more can I ask for here? It doesn't do early castling. It's the only downside. Knight c3 would be a pretty thematic move, too. What's interesting here is if d4, knight f6, and I take, and then knight takes e4. I have queen d5, knight d6, bishop b3. It's a game. My pieces are kind of offsides there. d4, knight f6, d5, knight a5, bishop d3. I really like castling too. I just don't want to commit to that direction of castling just yet, especially because I want to play d4 as soon as possible. Yeah, I think d4 against the Hungarian is reasonable. All right. So here we are playing our favorite Italian opening. Play that against anyone and everyone, at least I used to. I want to get back in the hang of playing it. So it's not my move in any game. So why don't I go this time instead of switching in the browser? One second, I've got to check a message here. Check this message, check this message. This one, okay. Emails and stuff build up. All right, so it's not yet my move in any game. Oh, that sounds like my move. Let's pick a game and see if this will auto switch me. Oh, here we are. Very good. So, the Sicilian, my old nemesis. I think I want to play the main lines of the Sicilian. Although I could play like the Alapin. Actually, I've never played the Alapin. That could be interesting. I could also play the C3 Sicilian, which everybody knows and hates. I think Zug, though, plays Knight C3. And then grandprix it with F4 and Bishop C4. Let's stick with what I know, which is the Knight F3, the open Sicilian. Just the main line stuff. Alright, D4. What do I want my repertoire against D4 to be? Do I always want to stick at the King's Indian, or do I want to pick up the Slav? I've been playing the Slav lately. It's been interesting. How about the Queen's Indian? I've always had respect for that opening. So the problem is if I play E6 right away, I could transpose into a French, which wouldn't be the worst thing in the world, I just don't know it that well. If I play knight f6, if he plays c4, I play e6, and then we get our Queen's Indian stuff going. I think, yeah, I'm gonna stick with knight f6. I think I'm gonna play Queen's Indian if I could remember that that's what I want to play. So now we're looking at d6. You'd think that I would have expected that. And that is a characteristic of this defense. So, I don't get something for nothing in every opening. So do I wait for him to play bishop g4, or do I play h3 first? I think I wait. I'm not sure. Where's this bishop going if I don't wait? Yeah, let me stop this. This looks reasonable. Knight f6. Well, do I stick with old faithful here, knight g5? That goes into lines that I haven't enjoyed very much over the years. Do I play d4? Venture into, what's it, the lally attack? I think I've seen enough of these d4 lines that I do enjoy it. I've certainly seen bishop takes f7 before also. Oh, goodness. Do I stick with what I know, which I don't really like? I don't especially enjoy playing knight g5. Like, it works, but it's not always what I'm aiming for. I could four knights this with knight c3, which feels hokey. I could play d4 though. D4 feels like a reasonable way to play this. But d3 seemed. I'm trying to think about this. I know d4 is a book move. I know d3 is a book move. I know knight c3 is a book move. I know knight g5. I even think castles is a book move. Question is, whose book move do I want to play? And what do I want to be my ultimate tournament repertoire? So the downside of knight c3 is that black could play bishop c5 and things get dull. Like, I prefer the sharper stuff with knight g5, but it. Yeah, I'm not sure what I'm doing. On the other hand, who better to learn this stuff against than a 2347? Like, if I play d4 and it doesn't work out, oh well, I've lost some Lichess rating points. It's not the end of the world, and it's a learning experience. I'm still trying to figure out, though, what if d4 takes. Well, he doesn't even have to take, but yeah, if he takes, knight takes, then knight takes e4. How's this go again? We can pull up our analysis board. So what I'm looking at is d4, pawn takes, knight takes, knight takes. I was thinking queen e2 here. I'm down a pawn, so I can't afford queen e2. And then bc. Yeah, this doesn't look any good. And yet I know d4 is a thing. Is it a gambit? Is that the deal? Is it like e5? And then knight e4? I forget. No, it's not knight takes there. Knight e4, this move, I think. This is going to be embarrassing. This is going to be really embarrassing if he takes that and I F it up. But no, I think the point is, like, you can't do knight e4. So the book move is d5. And then something like this. I think this is the point. So, yeah, let's play d4. I think I'm remembering things correctly. Hello and good luck. All right. Let's play e5. That looks fun. All right. Knight takes d4. Did not expect this. Well, so I'm not losing a pawn. I'm gonna recapture. All right. So he intends the Sicilian, not just the Sicilian, but the open Sicilian with d6 here. D4 is the main move. I've played it many times. You can transpose into various lines at Black's disposal. All right, so here I said I wanted to play Queen's Indian. That starts with e6. I've read about this opening. Not played it that much, but I've read a ton about it. So, we're awaiting a move on five games. How many more should I pick up? Let's keep making some more games. Let's make a correspondence 3 days per move. Let's make a correspondence 3 days per move. Let's make a couple more. And I think nine games at a time might be enough. Though why not make it an even 10? So we've got a couple going at 5 days, and eight going at 3 days. All of them rated, because why not? We're learning from this experience. And I can afford to make these things rated and still not stream the experience. Like, I'm just doing a video recording here. Okay. It's my turn on a game. I have been notified. So let's pick this up. Let's see, here's the one where it's my move. No, that's not it. Ah, here it is. Bishop f6. No, I was thinking like my threat's queen d5, bishop e6, queen takes b7. That's not a real threat, is it? I've always got queen e3 here. And until his knight lands on e5 or c5, queen d3 is reasonable, but e3 seems okay. Just gonna do queen d5, and then, like, if he played bishop e6, I was intending queen takes b7. Actually, hang on. Hang on a second. If I play this, if he plays that, I can take here. If he takes here, I can check. And if he blocks the check, I take the rook. If he moves the king, I take the bishop. So this is to say that against this, I can play queen d5. Bishop e6 is out of the question because that drops the pawn with tempo. So instead, he's going to play like knight e7 or queen e7 or something. Well, knight e7 would drop f7, but he's going to play queen e7. And after queen e7, I don't have a good move. I haven't done badly, it's just this isn't particularly good. And c6 is going to come, and then eventually bishop e6 and d5 with tempo. So while queen d5 sets this clever trap on bishop e6, my opponent's clever enough to not fall for that. So we're going to play something better. Like I said, queen e3 is meriting consideration. I'm actually, the more I look at it, liking queen d3 and then knight c3 and bishop e3 and castle. But the problem with this kind of setup, the problem there is that he's going to play his knight out and maybe even to g6 and e5 and it hits my queen. So I'd rather have my queen somewhere else. So I could consider queen d5, acknowledging that he'll probably play queen e7 or even queen d7 here. And now he's intending, hang on, he's intending knight to e7, and I guess he can't ever play that, but he can play c6 and d5. And this is ugly. And my queen does not belong there. So the question is, which retreat square do I want? D1 is an option, I don't like it. D3 seems to walk into him just playing his knight out and putting it somewhere reasonable. It does take time. E3 obstructs my bishop. Yeah, I'm thinking queen d3. Queen d3 is okay. All right, c4. Hello and good luck. All right, what do I play against what used to be my tournament repertoire? It might still end up being if I don't play better. I could transpose c6 into a Slav. Why do I want a Slav from this move order but not the other move order? I guess because I respect the English opening. I don't know. I'm weird. I'm gonna play knight f6. Hello and good luck. I say good luck. Unfortunately, I didn't click the button fast enough, but I can still type. All right. So, oh right, e4. Okay. Pawn takes pawn. I was thinking e5, if I remember everything correctly, and it's possible that I forget. But no, I think I'm right. I've had opponents play this sort of stuff against me before. Knight c3. Delaying on a decision. Do I play e6 anyway? Do I play b6? If I'm really going for a Queen's Indian, b6 is okay. I'm curious where that goes, and who better to test it against? Here we go. Okay, back to the old favorite. All right, open Sicilian, here we go. Hello and good luck. Against e4, always play e5. All right. Either he's watching me or he just knows. He's not watching because I'm not streaming this. He just knows. Okay. Do we bogo this up with Bishop B4 check? I mean, my goodness. Other things I would expect. G3, I would not expect. This is unique. Do I Benko it up? I think we're Benkoing it up, guys. C5. Here we go. Live it up, man. Bishop c4. All right. Old mainline openings. So I've got 7 games of the hopper at the moment. 3 sieges out there for 3 day games. Probably should have just sought for 3 day games from the beginning, because I'm pretty sure I could manage to make a move. Can I do something to configure all these notifications? Like, can I do something to say, like, if I'm online, don't notify me every single time it's my move? At least not on my device. I suppose that's probably too much trouble. So I'll just put up with the fact that it's gonna buzz every time it's my turn. Hey, it's my turn. All right. Yeah, no, I'm gonna go with this Italian opening. All right. Hello and good luck. Yo, what's up? Good luck. For some reason, I click the buttons, it doesn't always work. All right. Back to the old favorite. This is good stuff. Now, if we do get all the way into this opening proper, maybe I'm not going to play the gambit line I usually play. No, nonsense. We're going to play the gambit. 7 knight c3. If I have the opportunity to gambit it, I will gambit it. All right, so it's my move on one of the boards. I don't know which. It says in 3 days. That's the one that means it's my move. Okay. That's highly unusual to see somebody playing this against me. The last time somebody did that in a tournament against me, the kid was like 10 years old. He's playing with such confidence and didn't know that that, for many years, had been my pet repertoire. So he erred on the theory around move 15. And I guess he managed to successfully make it away from the game without crying, so good for him. Alright, I picked the one where it's my move. How about that? That's a good selection. Alright, so d4. But yeah, generally, if people play my opening against me, I tend to know how to play it. And it tends to go better for me than for them. So what are we looking at? It's not my move on any of my games just yet. At least I don't think it is. Should we bear some more time looking at some of these things? Like here, I was saying I'm going to Benko it up. So the point is, like, if he plays d5, I could play b5. And then capture a6, capture bishop takes a6. This is a theoretical line. Alright, it's my move on one of the games. I don't know which. My phone tells me it's my move. Alright, so I did guess correctly. Or remember correctly. D5 is the move. And I believe it's bishop b5, knight e4, knight takes d4. In fact, yeah, I had a game in the Twitch ladder that went just this way. Or maybe it got here by transposition. I don't remember. But yeah, the key is if knight e4, you play knight takes d4. No surprises there. Analysis board. Knight e4, knight takes d4. Add that back to the game. Alright. And then let's recapture. That's what we want to play. And then here, bishops to b4, knight c3. And that's ultimately what's going to happen here. Let's change it back to standard sounds, just so people don't get distracted by that. Okay. Like I was saying, the theory here runs pawn d4, pawn takes d4, pawn takes d4, bishop b4, check. Okay, it's my move on one of the games. Ah, knight e7. So like I said, he's aiming for the e5 square. Obviously didn't want to move the knight through h6. What I want to do for this game that's kind of special and unique is I want to go castle opposite sides and see how it plays out. I know I didn't mention that earlier, but that's kind of my goal here. So I have to move my knight before my bishop, otherwise b2 hangs. Unless I want to hang it, and I play bishop b2, bishop c3. He actually takes my rook, and then I take his bishop, and it's a sad gambit. So knight c3 is kind of forced. The alternative would be queen b3. Before knight c3. Queen b3, and he castles to defend f7. And there's not a whole lot of exciting stuff going on. Just optically, I prefer this move, though I'm not sure which is better. I think this move is acceptable, however, so I play it. Alright, so we played bishop b4, check, knight c3, knight takes e4. The most testing line here is castle. And we're in the thick of theory, guys. Hope you've been studying it. Because if not, this might be difficult to keep up. Theory says that black wants to capture on c3, and white wants to make some counter threats. And attacking the knight, attacking the bishop, leaving the knight on e4 on the open file, it's sharp stuff. And then bishop f6 happens next. And white pins the knight. Black retreats this way. After some tactics, crazy stuff happens. So we'll see it when we get there. But yeah, white manages to develop all his pieces with slight initiative. This is preferable, by the way, to knight takes knight, where after a pawn takes, or even a queen b3, white is better. So, I think we're going to see some pretty theoretical game there, which we haven't seen in Blitz. So it's good to be doing some of this correspondence stuff. I think I still have a couple more 3-day correspondence seeks out there, so we're only up to 7 games at the moment. Are my seeks still there in the lobby? Here it's my move. I don't see my seeks there, so let's put a few more out. Create a game. 3 days per turn. Create a game. 3 days per turn. Create a game. You get the idea. Please. Thank you. All right. Let's go back to our game. And then over to this one, which says I have to move in 3 days. All right, we got the main line, guys. We're going to get to see the theory proper. D5. Now, you might ask, well, can't black just move this knight, like knight a5, and hit this bishop? And okay, white takes a bishop, but he's still down a bishop. The answer is no. It doesn't work. But the opponent surely knows this, surely knows all the theory, as do I. And we'll get some interesting games on. Presently, white is down 4 points. So, if white doesn't make something of this, this could be quite bad. Consequently, people don't tend to study this opening because it looks bad. And this variation is actually slightly dubious. It takes a lot of TLC to make it even playable. You know what I was saying about remembering that I want to do a Banco? Let's put in the conditional moves for it. So d5, b5. I even forget how it goes. Just great. This doesn't look like a Benko, does it? I'm so confused. Because I thought in a Benko, white's not giving up the d pawn. And here, white seems to be on the verge of giving it up. Like, is this a Benko? No, that's not it. Man, how do you get a Benko? What is this? This is a Catalan. I'm so confused. All right, so our active game. Yeah, everybody is able to use that opening. That analysis tool that tells you what opening you're playing. I don't think it's unfair because people generally tend to use textbooks while playing correspondence chess anyway. So no d5. So now do I just play d5 myself or snap on d4? Do I play b6? If b6, I can line up my bishop on this long diagonal. Where else is my bishop going? Also, well, this isn't quite Nimzo Indian waters because there's no bishop, knight c3. I'm debating, do I plan to play knight c6, intending knight a5 if he plays d5? It just looks iffy anyway, because he could just play b3. Do I play b6 myself, which looks weird? Do I take d4 and then play knight c6? And I've transposed into a Sicilian. No, it's not a Sicilian because he played c4. I'm not sure. This is confusing me. I badly want to take it and play a6 and b6 and d6 and just hedgehog it up. If I play b6 immediately, I think he plays d5 profitably. No, if I play. Also, can I just play b5 here? Just confuse the ever-loving crap out of everybody. B5 seems unwise. B5 is going into way, way uncharted waters. Yeah, I think B6 is sane. Let's play it. Oh, guys. We got some theory on our hands. So, this is making me rethink what's going on here. I've not seen knight e5 in a very, very long time. I've seen, pardon me, I've seen knight a5 on many occasions, but knight e5. I have to rework out the details of why, after I take his bishop, he can't just take my knight. These details matter. I think the point is I check him and I have a interesting attack to follow. Knight takes knight is discouraged, I think. Like, I know this is in Modern Chess Openings 13th edition, because there's only a couple pages on this opening in that whole book, and this is one of the things they mention. But why can't I just take the knight? If knight takes knight, bishop takes knight, rook e1, queen h4? Attacking h2, g3. Looks murky. Spell that out for all of us. Because it's more fun to see these things on a board. If I take, black basically has to take this. Then I can pin these two pieces. Oh, we could just castle. That's the point. Then, say I take this. He goes back and he's up a pawn. That's the reason we take the bishop, is because the bishop's worth more than the knight here. It's an open position. So that's what we want to take. All right. Bishop d7. Now, I've played this before. Black threatens the elastic band of knight takes and then knight recapturing on d7. So white has to do something about this tension. White cannot simply ignore the tension. So does white take on c6 with the bishop or with the knight? I think it's a matter of preference. Knight takes. I don't know, I kind of like this knight centrally posted. Somehow I'm not as attached to the bishop. But I think things go bad quickly if I do bishop takes. Because I think. Yeah, his pawn kicks my knight. My knight lacks a good haven. Whereas if I do knight takes, pawn takes. I'm not sure. There's stuff going on here, and I don't know what. I think knight takes is okay. Then generally it's b takes that follows, and bishop d3, harassing this advanced knight. I think this is playable. We'll check out after the game what the theory says, but knight takes is playable. Ah, clever. Right. This takes all the wind out of my sails, unfortunately. Like, I'd been hoping to castle queenside, and he castles kingside, and sunshine and roses and stuff. Things aren't so simple. On the other hand, I could play knight d5. He takes, pawn takes, bishop moves somewhere. I'm not sure. That gets murky. But you can't avoid all the murk and still get some profit. You need to make things murky at some point. This isn't coffee house chess where you can just like play what you want and it'll all work out. This is correspondence, or you have to have some ideas of what you're doing. And this bishop here is very good. I could take. We see f takes. I could allow him to exchange on e4 or c4. My queen is somewhat developed there. I could drop my bishop back to b3. Could also check. He could elect to play c6. I run back. b5. I run back again. He might be overextended. Probably not. Of all these options, knight d5 looks the most appealing. But that doesn't make it right. He's got three pieces bearing on d5, as do I. So if d5 takes, knight takes, knight takes, bishop takes, bishop takes, queen takes, queen takes, I come out ahead. Though I'd need to precede this all with takes knight takes first, so there's no bishop takes knight. So I think bishop b3 might be best. After all that humming and hawing, I don't want to capture and let him build his center. Because a pawn on e6 helps him play d5 faster. I don't want to liquidate everything on d5. I'd rather not play bishop b5 because I'm left running anyway. So let's run. And I think this is okay. Yo, what's up? Right, e6. What do I play against the French? Queen e2 is okay against the French. Do I want to make that my repertoire? I think that could be simpler than other things. I'm curious where it goes. Do I play c3 against the French? No. Let's play Queen e2. Bring us closer to Scandinavian waters, but I don't know if I want that. Why am I avoiding? Yeah, let's play the fun stuff, guys. No need to weenie out with Queen e2. I'll say I'm from Illinois. So, Illinois, a strong bad would say. All right, so the main line here is knight takes pawn. And indeed, that's what I'm playing, unless I got some reason to deviate, which I'm pretty sure I don't. Why does this feel wrong? Knight c3. It's knight takes e4, castles, and then we take a. Yeah, right. Just had to flip the board around, that's all. So knight e4 is correct. Yo, what's up? All right. E5, here we go. Knight takes. So there have been recent developments in theory here, which I know I've been saying this doesn't work at all for black, but there are ways to make it playable. It's just not the most critical theory in the world. So I think the next move is generally Queen d4, although I'm trying to remember, is it Rook e1 instead? Rook e1, f5, knight. Oh, I'm sorry, f5 is terrible due to bishop g5. Which makes me think that Rook e1's the theory. But I remember MCO would say, like, Queen d4, knight cd6, queen g7, queen f6, queen takes. Okay, let me show you. Let me show you what we're talking about. We're talking about the old theory, this stuff. And it looks like black's pulled everything together. Though, if I remember right, there was a trap here. We take. Check. Now it looks like black is safe and secure. Like, if he plays king d8, and you play bishop here, and he's just losing the knight, right? If knight e4, rook takes e4. If knight e8. How does this go again? Oh, we're threatening f7. If rook f8, so he doesn't lose the rook. Then knight g4, and white collects the piece, and black's in an awkward position. I mean, yeah, black can survive this, but he's not doing very well. I think take. If knight takes, bishop takes. King there. Rook e7, king d8. Rook ae1. Threatening rook e8, winning a rook. Bishop f5. Yeah, this is a theory. And if king c8. Right. So that's the sort of thing I was studying when I was playing chess back in high school. That stuff. That's the old theory. Or older theory. I think there's new theory, though, that after queen d4. Black plays f5? No, I'm sorry, I'm still mixing this up. I said f5's terrible due to this. White wins instantly. No, I'm getting that mixed up with the rook e1 line. Never mind. White can't play bishop g5 here. I mean, yeah, white could just take c4. But Yeah, I think this is the newer line, the newest theory. Let me take here. And white's okay. It's funny to say white's okay, but point is, like, after this is the line where you can't play bishop g5 because this knight's pinned. So this collects a queen. But yeah, this doesn't work out so well. F5, F3, castle takes, 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 takes. This is just white's down a pawn. So this is why we play queen d4. Although the latest theory here is f5. And something happens. It's bad to end your opening preparation with "and something happens," but I think that's where mine ends. So, what if I play rook e1 here and say black castles? I can't sack and win a queen because the queen gets out. So that's no good in terms of that sack. I could take here, but if I delayed this capture, then like black has knight d6. So I'm thinking not that, but I think just take this knight. Black castles anyway. Oh, check here. And then we take here, and material is restored. Yeah, I think this is the line I want to place. Queen d4. Am I forgetting anything here? I hope not. Yeah, I know I've showed you, like, the traps, or a trap. That if black's trying to hold on to everything, not this line, the queen d4 line, if black tries knight cd6, I think I showed you that. Oh, in fact, yeah, that's the main continuation I'm showing here. Just not the line that black wants at all. Oh, so I was saying if black goes that way, he loses the knight, and things fall apart anyway. Right, because I'm just convincing myself here, really. This is the knight e5, the move that took me forever to study and figure out, but it's pretty simple. So that's the point of this stuff. Yeah, the key move of this study is rook ae1. And even if bishop e6, you just take that with discover check, and black's still falling apart. So king d8's not possible, which becomes pretty readily apparent. So black prefers king f8, except that doesn't work either. And the key to this variation is that this knight here is tied to the defense of e8. So white threatens mate on g5. Black needs to do something about that. How did it go from here? Oh, right. So white attacks this knight to renew this rook g5 mate threat. Black can't do anything. This knight's tied down. So he plays d6 to hit the rook, expecting the rook to move away from g5. And white sacks the rook with mate. So that's the point. So king f8's not playable either. King d8's not playable. Black's best move, I think, is knight to e4, and white just attacks the pinned knight. So this is all to say that queen d4 does recoup the piece, as we're going to find out in the game after I play queen d4. All right. I could swear bishop d3 is the book move here. Though I'm curious. No, I'm sorry. Knight c5 seems really weird. And not playable. I think bishop d3 is okay. This opponent's gonna give us quite a fight. Alright, here we go. Another mainline French. Okay, so he does castle kingside. That's what we were all hoping for. At least I was. You might not have been hoping for it. That's okay, I forgive you this time. So bishop e3 seems to make a lot of sense, unless there's some way he can exploit that. But no, e3 is an excellent square for the bishop. It just makes it more challenging to get to d4 than, say, if I played it to d2 and then moved the knight away and then got my bishop onto c3. But, I'm thinking my queen might have to move laterally this game, as in over to g3 or h3. So bishop on e3 would slow that down. Bishop e3 is not really hitting anything on the queen side, and might even be a target for a pawn or a knight. So bishop d2 has a lot of sense to it. The only thing is it prevents my queen from going vertically, but I'm okay with that. Okay, castles. Yeah, that's a move, for sure. I guess if I'm taking a knight, it doesn't matter which one I'm taking, does it? Oh, is the I forget, is the book here that White just grovels for a long time? If so, then maybe I'm not such a fan of this anymore. But we played it, so we're gonna play it to the bitter end. To the bitter end, he says. If I take on e4, he does get to. Well, if I take c4, he can play rook e8, protecting his knight. I could play rook e1, attacking it. He's got knight d6 at the discovered attack on my rook. I'm not liking that. I'm pretty sure the book move is that I take this knight. Let's take it. And White has a pretty comfortable hand, although he's down a pawn. Alright. Knight f6. So, let's keep in main line waters. Knight c3. All right, bishop there. Here's my clever innovation. It's probably not that clever, but it's a move. Let's see. And so many "it's your move" notifications, because we got so many correspondence games going on. I think we finally maxed out at 10 correspondence games. And fortunately, thankfully, many of these are moving quickly. Though some, because I did seek 5 days per move, will drag on for a while. So, which one do I want to look at now? Yeah, let's look back at our Italian opening game. I can't help but feel that queen takes c4 was the book move. Although, maybe knight e5 is seeing a renaissance because knight takes c4 and castles is okay. For sure, white's side is more comfortable. I took here. C4 is under fire. White has more space. They're really, I don't know. The pawn deficit isn't much to be worried about in such an open position, but this position is uninspiring, I suppose. So maybe here, maybe I should have, what should I have done to improve upon this? I thought that, like, bishop f6 is the old book move because black actually is much better. Well, not much better, but he's got dynamic counter chances, whereas here it's kind of stale. White has a space advantage. Black eventually can maneuver to do something, but it's a lot harder for black than for white. That's kind of why I picked this up in my tournament repertoire, is that, okay, it might be a long, agonizing game, but it's going to be a game, as opposed to some of these where I might get blasted out of the opening. It has not happened yet, though. So far, I've survived these openings. So, how many games do I have in progress? I've got, oh, 13 playing. And yet I can only see 7 at a time. Well, that's cool. That explains why a lot of games are in progress. That was 3 more than I thought. I saw 6 in the preview pane, and so I figured, oh, surely. Surely I'm only playing 10 games here. Because I saw 6, added 3 more, and then saw 6 and added 3 more again. Or something like that. So he castles. I could take d4 with tempo. Because I'm sure he doesn't want to trade knights. So he'd be playing queen takes. And then after knight c6. I don't even have to play immediately knight c6. I can delay that. On the other hand, he's not going to take on c5. Because if he does, he's not really gaining a tempo. My bishop is kind of sort of usefully placed on c5. Not really, but I guess, well, the point is that d takes c5 would avoid losing a tempo, as opposed to it gaining one. If I delay too long, he might just play e3, though I'd have to delay an awful lot for that to make any sense. I think I just want a bishop e7 and castle as soon as I can. As in now. Bishop e7 takes, takes. It's kind of not exciting. Also possible is just like queen c. No, queen c7 walks into bishop f4. Queen c8's okay, I guess. Knight c6, knight a5, b3 goes into part of the Nimzo-Indian, but we're not in a Nimzo-Indian. We've not exchanged this bishop for the knight. So yeah, I think I just take d4, and then bishop e7. And hopefully I can get d5 in before he can take advantage of it. That doesn't seem wise. Seems unwise, rather. Oh, here's a thought. I take, queen takes, bishop c5, and then I castle. I like that. That looks entertaining. Because there I'm gaining my tempo, getting in d5 a little bit faster. Though why do I want the queen on d5? That's the same as the position after pawn takes and then bishop takes there. Except his queen's on d4 instead of d1. Transpositions are hard, man. Transpositions are hard stuff. All right. Here we go. Mainline nonsense. We're gonna learn it by hook or by crook. Oh. Bishop d7. Preventing the like Rosolimo-ish lines with bishop b5 check. I think a rational thing to do here would be just I'm not sure. Oh, he's also preparing knight c6. Yeah, bishop e2 looks rational. Do I have better? I've not seen this move before. This makes me curious. So if I play bishop g5, he has to play e6. And then I can't play bishop g4 because I just play bishop g5 or bishop f4. I want to build a pressure on this pawn, but it's not happening. I feel like there's got to be something interesting White can do because of that move. Like, what about Queen F3? I just want to like exploit this B pawn being loose, but or Black's kingside not being developed. It's a little tricky to exploit now, isn't it? Bishop G5 looks really tempting though, because it does compel E6, and given that he just played Bishop D7, E6 is not the sort of thing he wants to play here. Or maybe it is. I mean, that's all consistent. Yeah. Bishop g5, e6, knight db5, attacking this. Queen b6. Well, I could do this bishop g5 and then f4 and then queen f3 and stuff, but I want to play bishop c4. It's the disadvantage of bishop d7 if it slows down his defense, his d5 advance. So where I'd normally put my bishop on e2, I can now put it on c4. And just permanently hold that d5 square. It's interesting. So many possibilities in this position, and so few of them often get that kind of consideration. C4, queen c7, I don't know. Queen d3. I see a6 and b5 coming, trying to hit this pawn. It appears White would normally have a pawn on d4, and so this bishop d7 would be just nonsense. Here it might be okay. My bishop's going to c4, I don't need to put it there immediately. I could prepare with f3 and bishop e3 and bishop c4 and then castle and dragon it up. Yeah. Should we go for a dragon? I want to see where this goes. All right. More mainline stuff. Here we go. So I was saying that if he plays knight c6, we're going to dragon this up anyway. What other conditional moves do we want to add? Do we have other sensible conditional moves to add? Was this my move? No, I just played bishop d3. It's not clear what he's going to do next. Let's go back to my profile page. Check out games in process or playing games. Is there anyone I want to add a conditional move on? B6 over there. I can't just say any in the bishop B7. Here would be a circumstance where that would actually not be fatal to pre-move that. Okay. Here's one where we could pre-move something. Let's add in a conditional move. Knight F3, knight C6, bishop C4, bishop C5. I don't think we're going to get that far, but if we do, we'll see that position come up a little bit faster. Any other conditional moves that make sense? Like, can I predict what my opponent will play here? Knight C3 castle, maybe? Yeah, once he plays knight C3, I might not want a castle anymore. Though, absolutely, I should want to. Because once he plays e4, and if I take there, he does knight takes, which is slightly less appetizing. Alright, so I know I have auto switch on, but I've got more games in process than it can show in this panel, so it's not going to always show me the game where I'm on move. Alright, so we are liquidating to some kind of French. So I can, in this case, finally, the notifications on the phone where it goes buzz, buzz, buzz are useful. It's a lot of notifications, but we're making it there. So I think we've made it to move five or so in most of these games. We've picked up an odd, lucky number of games. Wouldn't it be fun to intersperse this with correspondence Go, is what you're asking. You're asking that, I'm not. Because, yeah, I don't think that would be particularly exciting. Correspondence Go could take forever, man. Oh, is it my move? Ah, here we are. Never thought we'd see this on the board. Now, if I remember right, the main line goes e5, c5, queen g4. It's not queen g4 right away. Or is it? Could it be? I forget. You ask, how do you make it as far as myself? And forget, this isn't like the Nidorf, this is the French, it's that funny line in the French, the fun one. I mean, knight f6 can be good fun too here, but queen g4 has a pretty special name. And that name eludes me. You know, once I remember the name, though, I'll remember whether or not I can play queen at g4, or whether it's e5 first. Why can't I play it first? Is there something strategically flawed with that? Because I'm sure if I played that in an over-the-board tournament, yeah, my opponent would flip out at seeing that so early in the game. And I'm not sure I see anything wrong with it, but queen f6 looks like an interesting counter. Queen g4, queen f6, e5 is no fun. So you'd want to take on d5 instead, and then black just takes. No, can't take on d5 because his queen's moved. You could play like knight h6. And you're off to the races, but that's not the main line. pretty sure e5's the main line. So we're gonna play that. Okay, so this is kind of like a Caro. Except he's playing e6 instead of c6. Interesting. Well, that's a way to avoid theory, that's for sure. So, how much fun do I want to have with this game? We started in the French. Now we're going out of the French into something. I just want to chuck in g4. Like, it doesn't look sound at all. It looks exciting. I just want to play that. I don't see anything wrong with it. g4, knight gf6, bishop g2, knight takes knight, bishop takes knight, knight f6. So maybe not. How's this go? What if I do this? Or g4, knight gf6, bishop g5, bishop e7. Bishop here, knight takes, bishop takes, queen takes, bishop takes. Knight f6. This is nothing special, unfortunately. It looks special, but well, it's got too many weaknesses here for it to actually be a thing. So I can't goof around that way. As much fun as that looks, it's not that great. We've got bishop b5, perhaps, which inspires c6. Probably better, it's just a waiting move, like, I don't know, knight f3. He wants to play c5. Oh, I could play c4 here. c4 transposes us somewhere into a queen pawn opening. The point is if c4, c5, d5 is playable. But also if c4, he plays bishop b4 check, and I have to retreat my knight. How many pieces does he have on this? He's got two pieces. I've got two. With another knight move, he'll have three on there. So if I play bishop e3, I can slow down c5. I think slowing down c5 is my goal here. He might be aiming to play e5. Oh. Actually, that's problematic. So, yeah, let's just develop. Knights before bishops. Okay, e5. So, a little earlier than I would have expected it. How did we get here? Cd. Okay, that's interesting. So if I manage to get a stranglehold on this square, I'm golden, but can I do that? It's kind of tricky. I guess this is the drawback of playing f3, is that my knight has fewer squares to run to. I was thinking knight b3 here. He plays a5. I'm not sure what I do. Knight b5 also looks doable. Queen b6. I don't get to play bishop e3. Yeah, I think I have to play knight f5, because I don't have other places to put my knight. This is still an interesting game, but it's not where I thought we would have gone. So here we go. Okay, knight gf6. So I could run back with knight g3, threatening h4, h5. Honestly, not a terrible idea. Well, if I do that, he probably plays knight d5, and we maneuver around each other for a while. That's probably okay. I could play bishop d3, allow an exchange of a pair of knights. It's not very fun. I could play bishop g5, h6. Or, yeah, as we were looking at, bishop e7 even. It's nothing special. Just, the one thing I can't do is hang the knight. Basically, anything else is okay. So I could take this knight. If queen takes, that's a queen trap. Right? No, not exactly. So I've got an awkward position. That's what we can conclude here, is that this is awkward. I want to justify bishop g5, in my style. Justifying it would be bishop g5 here, and then if knight c5, suppose we exchange. Oh, he gets to trade the queens. I don't get to exchange, so it's not like... I was thinking of a different move order, where he takes here first, and then I trade queens, and this might be something. It probably isn't. No, it definitely isn't. So knight c5's not playable there. It's not playable in any position. Here we are in knight f6. Knight c3 is okay here. It's not what I dreamed of. It's okay. Knight g3 allows a future knight h5, but that aside, it's not very interesting. I'm just debating how badly do I want to avoid this exchange. Like, if he's threatening to take there. The more pieces that get liquidated, the less interesting this game becomes. What if we play bishop g5, he breaks the pin, and then I play knight d2. He plays h6, I go back, g5, I go back, g4, we attack. Okay, that's the plan. That's a plan. It's okay. Alright, so queen g4 is the book move here. Black could play king f8 against it. Hang on. It might be a3, bishop a5, and then queen g4. I think that's an important detail. Because in lines where black might play queen a5, if I just play this first, and I don't know. It could get ugly. Like, if I play queen g4, king f8, a3, queen a5, things are ugly. Because if I play a3, if he plays queen a5, then I can move my bishop. And I'm threatening to take his bishop. I'm going to lead off with a3. I don't remember what the book move is. It's probably queen g4. Alright, knight c5. I know I've played this before with strange results. I just always felt that my knight was better placed on e4 than on c5 or e6. So I'm okay retreating. That seems fine to retreat. Seems cowardly, but it seems okay. Tactically, does that lose me the e5 pawn? I don't think so. Plus, it allows me to put my bishop on the longest diagonal, going toward this rook. Although it does cede this useful diagonal to black. I want to see where this goes. Okay, knight c3. I just want a castle here. That's what I was saying. Because, although if I don't, if I castle, he could play e4. Now if I take, he could do knight takes. And then we're into a proper Sicilian line that I don't know that well. Whereas if I take immediately, he's got to do queen takes, and we're into Scandinavian territory. Though he's got a tempo that he could play rook d1. Could complicate my efforts to play d5. I don't want to take. He who takes first loses ground. Okay, so we do this, we do that. Okay, bishop c6. So, I think the problem with that move is that bishop g5. Oh, I'm sorry, he could play h6 to kick my bishop. Still, I've got the d5 square under control. Like h6, I just exchange, queen takes, bishop c4, and that square is mine. I could always play bishop g5. I don't need to play it right away, but when I do, it's going to work out fantastically. So, wait, bishop g5, he can't break the pin either. Not that he needs to. Let's just develop this bishop. There are no checks in this position, there are no captures in this position that worry me, so that's the move. I control the square 4 times to my opponent's 3. So it's going to be very difficult for my opponent to play d5 this game without sacrificing material. The fact that I played bishop c4 first means that if he plays queen b6 at some point, I can play bishop b3 to cover my b2 pawn. So that works out okay. Yeah, of all the games, this one has me the most curious as to what's going on. What a position. Actually, I could turn off the buzzing on my phone. There we go. So I'll silently get the notifications, but that doesn't help. It'd be actually better that I get to hear these buzzing noises. Even though they might not annoy you so much, they do slightly annoy me. Actually, this position's interesting as well. So there, whoops, there's. I've played in this position, knight d6. I've played knight b6. I think one time I even played b5 and learned that that's no fun and don't play that again. Oh, hang on. I heard a move noise. Click. Switch boards. Oh, there it is. I guessed correctly. A6. Well, so I could play a4 to counter a6, but I don't need to. But a4 all the same might be simplest. I think if I play bishop g5, though, the pressure on f6 will become obvious. Even more so than it is now. Could also just play bishop e3. Oh, but then that denies my knight the e3 square. So, suppose I play a4. Obviously, he wants his queen on this long diagonal where my king might be. Yeah, I want to just play bishop g5, queen d3, and castle quickly. And I'm not necessarily afraid of these queenside pawns. He's developed two pieces, I'll have developed four. I can fight off whatever he throws at me. Or at least hold off his attack long enough for me to strike back. But, that all said, why don't I just play a4 here? Is there a downside to playing a4? It's that I can't castle queenside. Do I really want to castle queenside? Is that what I'm aiming to do here? Bishop g5, bishop b3, b5, bishop b3, a5. I mean, you could commit the entire kitchen sink on the queen side. And I. Okay, I will put this on the analysis board because I can see it in my head. I'm not doing it for your benefit. Well, yes, I am. I've already. I'm not doing it for my benefit, is what I meant to say. That I've already seen this position. And this is what I foresaw. And that worst case, I can exchange on f6. And get my bishop out of here. This doesn't work so well, does it? So this is my great plan. I said I'm not doing this for my benefit, but it actually helped me a bit. So is this what I'm afraid of? Bishop b3 accelerates his attack. I don't like that one bit. So yeah, that's why I'm hesitating here, is because I didn't see anything convincing. In fact, a4 is okay. It just means that castling queenside is not necessarily in the cards. Okay, so here we are. Black is developing normally. White hasn't committed to which way he's going to castle just yet. It certainly looks like kingside, because that's the convenient way to go. But that also looks less fun than less adventurous. We'll say, than the queenside castle. In this position, I could play knight c3, and he can't immediately strike with d4. Problem with knight c3 is then he could play rook to b8. And that's kind of weird because my bishop on c1 is tied to that b pawn. And yes, I could play b3. But if I'm going to go. Well, it just seems that's leaving a lot in the center to the opponent. Like, if I'm going to be pushing pawns on both sides, and I've given up a lot of the center, that's probably not a very solid way of playing. Knight d2 to knight f3 is okay. It doesn't net anything on the queen's or king side. Could also play c4, but that. C4 hits d5. He plays bishop e6. Not seeing anything. I don't want to castle king side because my chances on the queen side don't look that great. I'd rather throw everything in on a kingside attack. But I'm not seeing any kingside mate here. I think knight c3 keeps the most tension in the position. But rook b8 leaves me awkward. But no, I don't intend to put my knight on b3 though, because a5, c5, and all that could happen, and my knight would be very sad on b3. So c3 is the best square for the knight. So the question is to play it now or play it later. It seems fairly obvious that knights before bishops, just play it now. That's a good common sense move. D4 cannot be immediately played in response. Alright, so we got the bishop pair, guys. Hooray! That's the one thing we can say that's positive about this. A negative thing we could say is that we missed the book line, which was Queen G4. That's a bit embarrassing. That's okay. Oh, we don't need the book. Books are for people who know where they're going. What fun is playing the game if you know how it's going to end? There's only some truth to that. Do I play bishop? No, do I play c4? Just sacking a pawn. The answer's probably not. C4 if you sorry, if I play bishop d3 and he plays c4, these pawns on the queen side are very hard for him to attack. So bishop d3 is okay. Even provoking c4. I want to see where that goes, if he's willing to go into it. So let's see if I provoke c4. Alright, d5 it is. I've got pressure on the d5 square. He's intending d6 if I just completely ignore it, which would be bad. Could be worse, but looks terrible, hideous. And he's able to support d6 once played, so that's even worse for us. So if I take, pawn takes is kind of forced. Well, I'm sorry. Take knight takes is the alternative, and then I do knight takes, and I'm out of a bind. Generally, it's good to play d5 once you've supported it with your e pawn, I think. So I think this is actually a good exchange for black. And that if white captures on d5, knight takes. Or I'm sorry, knight takes, knight takes, pawn takes, d6, and then I'm threatening bishop f6, g6, bishop g7, knight d7, knight f6, and so forth. Or knight e5, rather. So you don't even need to fianchetto, just play bishop f6 and your knight over to e5 and rook e8, and black's got some useful ways to develop there. I think most testing is c takes. So I'm just debating, like, if he does knight takes. Like, I said that black could do all that stuff by trading knights, but maybe he doesn't want this bishop so much. That seems crazy. Yeah, if knight takes, just knight takes, and the knight f or bishop f6, and everything's a-okay. Blue skies everywhere. Let's see. Knight takes. Knight takes. Cd. Bishop f6 is what I was saying. I don't even see a hurry to play that. I could just play d6 first. What would I want to play here? Assuming we got here. Would it be d6? Would it just be bishop f6? It's got to be bishop f6, right? Maybe even rook e8. Like, that's the one thing that seems clear in this position is that the rook wants to move over. let's add that as conditional moves to this game. There's no way that's happening because he's going to play cd5 instead, but, you know, if he does otherwise, then great. Let's add some conditional moves here. This is the sort of situation where your opponent has a good chance of playing a move and you know exactly what you're going to do in reply. This is where conditional moves speed up the game. If he plays cd, we want to play cd. Let's add that. Let's go back to our game list. Oh, is it my move here? Yeah, like I was saying, cd5 is surely what he's playing. The other line is too freeing. And he still intends d6 if I'm just stupid. So I either want to play rook e8, or I want to play d6 myself. d6 itself is kind of difficult for him to attack directly. I mean, bishop f4 could hit it. But other than the bishop, I don't see him being able to hit this pawn. Rook e8, if he plays d6, I have to go bishop f8. And this d6 pawn is really disruptive, and he can protect it with his bishop and then drop his knight on c7 and stuff. So I'm not doing myself any favors by delaying that move. Unless I think somehow I can collect it, but that seems unrealistic. Let's take a look. If I just ignore it and pretend it's going to go away, will it really go away? It's got two pieces defending it. I have one attacking it. I mean, I could develop around it, but that looks unpleasant. I can't do knight d5, which is what I want to do. Yeah, so this is nonsense. We're going to play d6. Yes, confirmed. Alright, he castles. Okay, so main line, as we all know, is bishop takes knight. Quite common is for white to just play pawn takes bishop in response, and black plays d5 to equalize. And then just shake hands and say, let's set up the pieces again. This is kind of why, for black, I should pick up like the two knights or something instead. Because I don't particularly care for... This isn't the Benko, is it? Benko is that other thing we were looking at. This is the... I'm drawing a blank. That's terrible. Oh, this is the Evans Gambit. The other five-letter opening gambit. Just kidding. But yeah, this is the Evans. So, I don't care for the Evans. I don't care for the pianissimo. I guess I don't enjoy the piano. So it's hard to say why I'm playing this other than just ignorance. I should pick up the two knights. It'll be a little bit harder since I don't know all the lines. But I used to have such fun playing this a long time ago, and it's not as fun these days. Because adults don't hang all their pieces. Okay. So as we were saying, the main line goes d5, bishop f6, rook e1 now, I think? Rook e1, knight e7, rook takes e4, d6, I think? We're not going to see all this in the game, because there's no way the opponent knows every bit of this. And then bishop g5, takes g5, takes g5. And then black has a couple options. He could castle and draw by perpetual check. Or he could play h6, I think. Let's add this so far. Yeah, it's complicated stuff. We're not going to see that in the game. There's no way. Like I said, this isn't streamed live. This is me recording it. Because I don't have the bandwidth to stream at the moment. So. I can't get a listing of all my current games. That's unfortunate. I can go over to my profile. And then for my profile page, I can look at playing games. From here, I can see everything in progress. So I played A4 there. D6 here. Yeah, it looks like a lot of these have stagnated. So the main objective of playing X days per move games is that you're not in time pressure, generally speaking. Positions can get pretty complex. But you have time to think things through. You're not compelled to use all that time, of course. But if you want to, you can. And I think at this point, all 13 of my opponents are using their time to think. So maybe I should have gone, I don't know, to like a 1 day per move time control. I could always throw in some 1 day per move things. I really don't like doing that. Because, well, I don't know. There's always the possibility that something comes up and you need to have a vacation day or you need to deal with real life circumstances. And that makes it, that's just a lot harder to deal with at 1 day per move. All right, so we're looking at black plate castling, which makes sense. And I've been saying for a while that what I really want to do this game is launch opposite wing castling attacks. Now that knight prevents my queen from going to d3. I could do queen d4, but then he plays knight e6, and my queen has not very many places to go. Alternatively, I could lead off with, like, bishop e3. But I still have some difficulty castling queenside. The idea with knight c3 was that black would give me some hint as to what he's doing, and then I could make a decision as to where I want to put my pieces in response. And honestly, I do want to launch an opposite side attack, because that'd be the most fun thing to do. But in terms of how to do that, man, it's not looking feasible. If I could find some even halfway reasonable way to do it, by all means, I'll go for it. But here, this just doesn't look, I don't know. I don't think I could get enough pieces over to that side of the board fast enough to make anything happen. The position demands I do something different. It would take quite a feat for me to be able to do that sort of attack here. Is there some crazy tactical means here, like bishop e3, rook b8? I don't think so. Also, what I'm really concerned about is the longer I leave my king in the center, the more exposed I am to attacks. B3 and bishop b2 might be completely unwarranted. It also might get me in a ton of trouble after he plays moves like c5 and c4. And I haven't even played h4 yet. I haven't played g4. Like, I've got nothing moving on the king's side. So, I'll need to, if I'm going to play that, I need to find a way to deal with the threats he's going to conjure up. does my bishop belong? Where's my bishop on c1 going? I would say f4, except then it's only attacking the c7 pawn. And c7 is really difficult to access and very well defended. I would say e3, except then c5 and d4 are happening very soon thereafter. I would say a whole bunch of other places, except it really doesn't belong in any of those other places. It belongs on b2. Granted, my opponent's going to blockade my e-pawn. It's going to be difficult. But, well, the other place it could belong is d2 instead of b2. But then b2 itself is weak and easily attacked. Well, I wanted an opposite side castling game, and now my bishop has nowhere else to go than for me to go right into this. So the only thing I could do to delay is like queen d2 to queen f4, and see if he can make something useful of those free tempi I give him. And I'm sure he can, with like f6 and blasting open the center. I can't delay that long. I need to do something. So this is what I wanted to do, and this is what I'm doing. And we'll learn pretty soon how complicated that can get. I know I've been treating it pretty superficially this far, but complications are starting to arise, man. Alright, so how are we doing? It's been a couple hours of correspondence chess. We're making progress in all the games. And just check in on what the Discord says. Let's see. Yeah, Lichess is, the developers are working on a new feature for studying endgames. So wow, they're doing a lot of testing in these new endgame positions. You have to give them credit for that. Okay, did I hear a move? I did, and f6 is played. And I thought certainly f6 is an idea in this position. I thought I was completely okay after f6, though. Okay, just take, bishop b2. If knight e4, I've got queen d3 hanging on. I was thinking, worst case, it comes to this. And worst case, if somehow this gets attacked, I was thinking I just defend my knight. And I guess if this, then, I don't know, queen f3. And here, so I'm attacking that, but I don't think I should allow any of that anyway. I think a better thing to do is to attack this, or defend this. And if black tries to win material, Wait. So, okay, I have to analyze this, because what I was thinking is kind of bunk. F6. Now, I can't sack on d5, and at the same time, if I take on f6 first, this exposes my rook. I really don't want to play f4 here. That kind of blasts to pieces my ideas of a long-term kingside initiative. I might have to play f4, which would just be basically admitting that I've screwed up. That might be necessary. But let's take a look first, see if we can find something. Knight e4. I was thinking this. Wait, what did I just come up with a second ago? I found something that was disturbing about this. Well, for one thing, you can take here and then take f2. Which really depends on your level of comfort with this sort of thing. This looks uncomfortable, but might be okay. Think he just pulls back, and I'm in another fork. Don't have to go there, I could also go up here. But I'm not gonna trade my queen for the knight. So if knight e4, this is like an exchange sacrifice then. Or worse. I was thinking like I had some shot here, but I don't. So bishop f6. I'd have to play my bishop to b2, or d2. Then he has this anyway. I take and I sack my rook for the bishop. So there's all kinds of reasons not to take this f-pawn. Oh, right, the line I was looking at earlier was queen d4, knight e6. And I was trying to figure out what do you do about stuff. This is complicated. Though not nearly as complicated as I'm pretending it is. So, f6. My goodness. I have to do something to defend this because I can't take, and queen d4 is no good. I was thinking surely f4 would also be okay if somehow everything else I miscalculated or calculated just doesn't work out. I have to go this way. And takes, takes. Bishop h4 is nothing to fear. But, yeah, this is looking pretty rickety. I don't want to activate the bishop. Or his bishop, rather. I can't sack on d5 because his bishop's there. I can't just drop the e-pawn either. Because I don't have any clever sack to follow it up. Like, say I were to just ignore this, and then I sack here just for lols. I could even play this. I could take here, and then I'm skewered. Yeah, and that's the end of that story. So is there anything wrong with defending this? It itself could be attacked. I could defend it too. This looks okay. I think I've had a game where I was playing black and my opponent did this against me and he ended up playing f4 here also. So I think I'm still in theory. It's just I haven't seen that in a long time. Okay. So I wanted opposite side castling here. Looks like I'm getting it. Is that true? Oh, I wanted to stop d5. I forgot about that. That's no good. Okay, so I have to start from equal ground. That's no fun. Well, exchanging gets me nothing. Yeah, I want to play more of these sorts of positions, so we're going to play it. Queen c7. So the point is that there's a silly discovery against my bishop. I just play queen d3, I'm okay. Because he can't get his knight to b4. I mean, he can get his knight to c5. So I can't just ignore that. Queen c7 does take away a protector of the d5 square if you were to play d5, so it's not as if he's getting something for nothing. I do want to move my queen forward. I'm not sure that d3 was the square I had in mind. I mean, I'm sorry, I meant to say I'm not sure that e2 was what I had in mind here. Also, he's doing away with shenanigans I was threatening over there. Bishop b3 is okay. I just keep delaying castling turn after turn. The more typical thing you'd see usually would be like queen b6 and or b5, but b5's not happening here. Black's kind of cramped. This looks sensible. I'm probably going to end up castling kingside, even though it looks like I'm going the other way. Okay, so clarify how we got here. Bishop f6, main line, rook e1, knight e7, rook takes e4, d6, that, and then I have to choose here, do I castle, which is the drawish line, or do I play, oh, that's right, h6, queen e2, pawn takes, rook e1, bishop e, yeah, let me show you. So I play the main line, where black is slightly better, but has to be extremely sharp, or he has to be extremely cognizant of what he's doing. Why am I using arrows? Why don't I just move the pieces? So this is the old main line. Black's actually slightly better here. Ever so slightly, if he plays everything perfectly. Black's actually doing well here. My opponent seems to be following the book to the letter. So we could play this out, get really deep into theory. Or we could play castles and the knight takes h7 draws by force. Or black gets a far worse position. For example, castle, knight h4. If king takes, I think is it queen h5? King back, rook e1? Ay. This stuff is sharp, and I don't play this because the other line's better. So, yeah, we're gonna play the dangerous line. I've had strong opponents who have played the castles line. Yeah, h6 is the way to go for an advantage. That's the theoretical move. Okay, d4. Highly unusual. I almost scoffed at that right here, saying, "Wow, that's terrible. Why would an opponent play that?" And then I managed to restrain myself, because there might be something to this. I mean, surely there is. My opponent's rated 2100 something. He has some idea what he's doing. It just seems spectacular to me that that's even a move here. So, point one, this can't work. There's no way that knight d5 works. Because if that worked, my opponent wouldn't have even considered this. Takes, takes, takes. Yeah, I don't have any shots. Like, this hitting the rook doesn't work. Over here, this doesn't hit the rook. So there's no shot in this position with knight d5. Point two is that, like, he's doing this all with tempo. Three is that bishop takes bishop. Like, okay, this is part of point two, is that this is all done with tempo, right? My bishop's hanging. I could take two pawns for my bishop because, but that's no good. You need more than two pawns for bishop. So, point four is that the pawn's not hanging, like, outright. Like, if I move to collect it immediately, this gets ugly. Not to say I shouldn't play this, but I don't think I'm winning a pawn. So I hit that. He hits back. His attack's temporarily moving faster. But I do have this threat. I'm threatening to follow up with f4. But he plays this right away. So, knight e2's too slow. Knight b1 might be forced. Well, yeah, he plays this. Where's my knight going? Well, there might be something to this. If I, like, take here, and knight f4, I'm hitting this. He's got to defend it. And I don't have anything. So knight on that square is kind of dull. Or dim. Knight on b1 might be okay. It guards some relevant squares. It's by no means an attacking piece, and my attack has completely subsided. I don't like that. This might be okay for white, but it's not my style. I don't go down without fighting. So we fight. Absolutely, we fight. Okay. See, he recaptures. I'd fully intended pawn takes pawn here. Rook f5, queen d4, knight e6 stuff. I'm pretty sure I'm okay. I could just be blind. I could be just losing a pawn. Like, somehow I didn't even see that during my analysis, but. Like, okay, I guess I saw it. I didn't think that was a serious thing. Because this is so spectacular. It just seemed like this is the sort of thing that just never works. I think white's okay here. I'm probably wrong. Wow. Okay. D4. Queen e4 doesn't do anything special. This might be okay. But then he's got that. But then I have this check. But he attacks my queen. That's no good. How did I think this pawn would be okay? I assure you that's not that I saw something like this. Because the knight defends this and the queen defends that. So everything's still flexed just fine here. Fe5, rook f5. If I sack it, am I okay? Probably not. Oh, we can't do that, but I mean, there's a lot of things you can do here. Like that. Nope, we can't do that either. What does he do here? So white's gambited a pawn for this position. Doesn't seem to be enough compensation. All right, so he's taken there. Think I have to take back, but after rook f5, maybe I just do this. Bishop or rook e5 and then castle kingside. I'm down a pawn, but I'm still alive. I don't know. Is there anything else I can do here against rook f5? Nope. There sure isn't. I've got bishop e3, right? But all my forks don't yield anything. Like if I do this, then I fork his pieces. His bishop's defending the knight. There's no point to doing that. If I take here, how is this okay? I'm getting schooled here. It appears I'm losing a pawn and giving the initiative, because, like, without multiple pawns on that side of the board, I'm not really doing very much. Whew, boy. So taking e5 doesn't has so limited benefit and so many detriments. Might be better than not taking, but not by much. So that's amazing. It's amazing to me. I didn't see this rook f5 idea. Well, I saw it and didn't take it seriously. Seriously would mean taking it to a conclusion. I did some really speculative, shoddy analysis, and now I'm paying for it. I don't want to castle kingside. Castling kingside's not in the picture. I'm going to take this pawn. He's going to play rook f5, and the crying will commence. But that's what we're doing. All right. So I was saying a takes b3 this whole time, thinking that I want. Yeah, I definitely want to have a c pawn to stop his d pawn. So a takes b3 seems to be the common sense move here. C takes b3, and then he plays c5, and things are scary. I, this is not a typical position anymore, though. So maybe. No. There's no way the crazy moves work here. Also, I could just keep my pawns on the same rank as each other and do queen takes. I'm not going to get to take this d pawn anytime soon. And the d pawn's not advancing either. My queen doesn't like the square it's on, so it seems like a win for everybody. Let's do that. That seems like a good compromise. Alright, so he's intending queenside castling now. So this is the opposite of the way we thought the game would progress. That's okay. So I think now I castle. And he shuffles his pieces a bit. There we go. Okay. He's intending there. He might have other plans in mind too, but Knight F5 seems to be something he's intending. Do I play Knight FD7 or Knight G4 here? Knight G4, Knight F5, Bishop F6. H3, Knight E5, F4. My pieces are misplaced. It's the conclusion of that. He wants to throw everything on the king side forward. I want to develop this rook. Oh, but then he gets Bishop G5 in, which is pretty annoying. G6 looks okay. If Bishop H6, then Rook E8. Bishop G5, I'm not sure. Also, I haven't developed all my pieces yet, but I don't want to exchange this bishop for this knight. Maybe I do. I have too many pieces, so a single minor piece exchange would be useful. But I like my bishop. It's one step away from a really good square. And probably will be for a very long time. Because, like, if I move my knight, he plays knight e4. And I don't have any way to get my bishop to f6 without trading it for that knight. If g6, bishop g5, it's still difficult to develop stuff. Yeah, Rook E8 is part of a typical Benoni. We're gonna play that. Face the complications as they come. Alright, so lots of games in progress. If knight f5, then bishop f8. Bishop g5, then h6. It's gonna take some work for me to get my pieces to useful squares, but I'm fighting for this square. And I might be able to get things moving on the queen side fast enough to collect a d pawn or an e pawn, but very likely not, because this bishop's here. So this is like a Banco where white has all the initiative and black has not sacrificed the pawn. Which is pretty weird. Not gonna lie. What are we looking at? You know, next time I should just consider playing a proper simul. Because a simul has a finite duration. This could go on for days. This is more flexible, but. This could go on for quite a while. The problem with simuls, though, is people tend to move quickly, and they don't use their time, which is the same thing, but yeah, so usually the host giving the simul easily wins a whole bunch of games, or I don't know. Yeah, the host either just wins a bunch of games, or the few opponents that remain take forever. And the way this is structured, at least I have time to think, and I'm not being pushed over on the clock, which is good. I just happen to have a little bit too much time to think. Let's do this for another half hour or so. Maybe we come back a little bit later and try to make some more moves. So what are we looking at? Can I see all my games? I can't. I mean, I already know that, but... How many tabs do I have open? I've got this one, I've got this tab open. Okay, and then just this one remaining, right? So... we've got 13 games in progress. It would not surprise me if some of them I just won a move two after timeout, because some of these opponents are taking a minute or two to come up with their second move. Yeah, this English in particular, where I played b6, looks fun. Hopefully it ends up being fun. This French here, where I'm playing bishop d3 and offering, oh, just play c4. That could be entertaining as well. Yeah, I suspect it's going to be a while before I see another move here. So what do we do? What do we do? Maybe start tidying up the place a bit. Let's see, which game would you guys like to look at? I'm gonna say probably this one. This is the one you're probably most interested in, because Black has tons of options at his disposal. I think White will probably play knight e3 and then knight d5 at some point, but it's unclear what Black plays first. That decision needs to be made first. Also, now that I've been playing for a few hours, opponents surely have other commitments than I do, so that's why it's taking them a minute to come up with things. And that they might not be at their mobile devices or computers anymore. So I took a short just break to move around a little bit. I tend to think better when I'm not just sitting in one place. So yeah, it occurs to me that it's going to be a while before we see some next moves. So I think I will wrap this up here. So hope you enjoyed that. This is how you play correspondence chess. You could play it either rated or unrated. I'm playing rated, in hindsight maybe unrated might have been a better decision. I'm not sure. Don't worry about the fact that like this overflows on top of the board or underneath the board. That's just my custom style that's not working 100% the way that the standard style works. I find this font and font size and all that a little bit easier to read for myself. Anyway, yeah, thanks for watching, and I hope to see you around. Take care.